The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man came running up, knelt down before him and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to share in everlasting life?" Jesus answered, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." He replied, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my childhood." Then Jesus looked at him with love and told him, "There is one thing more you must do. Go and sell what you have and give to the poor. You will then have treasure in heaven. After that, come and follow me." At these words, the man's face fell. He went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples could only marvel at his words, so Jesus repeated what he had said, "My sons, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to pass through a needle's eye than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." They were completely overwhelmed at this and exclaimed to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus fixed his gaze on them and said, "For man it is impossible, but not for God. With God all things are possible." Peter was moved to say to him, "We have put aside everything to follow you." Jesus answered, "I give you my word, there is no one who has given up home, brothers or sisters, mother or father, children or property, for me and for the gospel, who will not receive in this present age 100 times as many homes, brothers and sisters, mothers, children, and property, and persecution besides, and in the age to come, everlasting life." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It is faith that is so important, because to enter the kingdom of God is very hard, and thus faith costs. Today's gospel account, taken from the Gospel of St. Mark, is likewise reported in Matthew and Luke. Anytime an event or the words of Jesus are reported in 3 of the gospels, they need to be taken especially seriously. It means that the words of Jesus and the account were of extreme importance to all of the early Christians wherever the evangelists went. All 3 use the exact same words in reporting this event and how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. Also, the Bible reports several people whom Jesus especially loved. There was, of course, his own mother Mary. Another was Lazarus, the man he raised from the dead, as well as his 2 sisters, Martha and Mary. And then St. John the Apostle is specially designated as the beloved disciple. And finally, there was this young man whom we just heard about in today's gospel account. St. Mark tells us that Jesus, in answering the young man's question, looked deeply into him and loved him. He loved him enough to give the young man an answer that would bring him a richness of life far beyond anything this world could ever offer him. And so we heard Jesus looking at him, loved him, and said to him, "You're lacking in one thing. Go, sell what you have, and give it to the poor. And you will have treasure in heaven. Then, come, follow me." We need to focus on the rich man, young man's question. Asking, of course, the right question gives us the proper direction, leading to a needed answer. Not asking the right question only leads us into a morass of dead-end pseudo-answers. And notice here that the rich young man did not ask, "How can I help?" or "How much money do you need?" No, rather, he asked Jesus how he, wealthy as he was, could receive an even greater inheritance than that which was already coming to him, because he knew that for all his worth, that wasn't it. We have all heard the phrase, "Be careful what you ask for, you might get it." And such is the case here. Jesus asked him to make a risk capital investment, to place all that he had and all that he was into God's care, into God's hands. Jesus asked him to give up the security of his wealth, family position, and power, to give up his independence and become dependent, to hand over his self-governance and so allow God to govern, God to control, God to direct his life. Sadly, the rich young man thought that Jesus' answer to his question was too costly. He couldn't bring himself to pay the price. He turned and left the company of Jesus because, as the Gospels report, he had many, many possessions. St. Peter likewise had to face the question. On one occasion, he bluntly said to Jesus, "We have left everything and followed you. What then are we to have?" Jesus responded that he would be repaid 100 times over and inherit everlasting life as well. And as we all know, Peter's response was wobbly. Nevertheless, he did in the end take up the risk. And so thereupon Jesus called him Rock, the rock upon which he would build his church. Things of great value come at a high cost. Living a life of value comes at a cost. Jesus speaks of that in this parable, you know it, the pearl of great price, which presents us with the question, what is of lasting value? What is an investment I can make that will give me something that can never be devalued? Cheap things that do not last can be bought cheaply. That which has great and lasting value comes only to those who are willing to pay the price. Will you sell your soul for something cheap? Or will you sell all that you have to acquire the priceless pearl? Are we willing even to face the question at all, or do we simply plod ahead through dreary lives, setting the question aside without ever answering it, making a conscious decision to turn our life over into the care of God is a major step, especially in any recovery program. That's the major step. Decision to turn our life over into the care of God. Every recovery program has that. And likewise, if we wish to recover our lives and rid ourselves of our addictive self-concerns and habitual self-gratifications, we must likewise turn our lives over into the care of God. It is, however, a risk capital investment that many judge to be too costly. So what are you willing to risk? You and I are here in church today because we claim to be Christian, to be a follower of Christ in his way, in his truth, and in his life. If you are radical about your commitment to Christ, then you will be faced with living a risky life. It is a great risk, a costly one, to live life as Christ did, to live as one of his own, to be loved by him. The testimony of history is that economics will not save humanity from its misery. The plagues of war, racism, and poverty have existed and exist now in many economic systems. Nor will science save us. We have only to take a look at what we have done with all the newly discovered scientific wonders. Nor will technology save us. And the internet is both a blessing and a curse. It cannot save us. What will save us comes from our hearts and souls, not from our brains and hands. Knowledge is not, has not, and will not save us. Wisdom offers us more. Wisdom bids us place our lives, our fortunes, our treasures, and our talents into the care of God. Wisdom transcends facts, information, and data, taking us into realms far beyond simple cognitive comprehension. It is a risk to stand up for the value of human life. You will not be popular, because the value of human life is found at its very beginning, called conception, and how it is lived out, and how it is protected at its end. There is a risk in being known to be a moral person. The cultured despisers of religion will attack you, accuse you of being a hypocrite, and go on to accuse you of attempting to impose your own private and personal religion upon others. The risk of living as a person filled with the presence of God means that you must stand under the judgment of Pontius Pilate, who asked truth, what is truth, as he handed Jesus over to be crucified. By the way, speaking of despisers of religion, especially those of the Catholic religion, which is the most popular to be despised, I just learned from a UN non-governmental organization representative who said that a few years ago, another NGO invited some Franciscan friars of renewal, and you know them, they wear the gray habits when they come for Catholic Underground on the first Saturday of the month in the evening. They live a very exacting Capuchin Franciscan life. They have a futon for a bed and a desk and one extra gray habit. And they inspire people to pray. Now, as you know, at the meetings at the UN, you'll see all kinds of uncommon clothing from the different continents and nations. But when many of the delegates saw the friars and their habit, they went absolutely apoplectic. What did they symbolize? The Catholic faith. And so some have accused them of intimidating people by praying with those who ask. How do you do that? I don't know. I know that Satan is intimidated when we pray together. I didn't know that it was a necessary quality for a delegate to the UN. Living as a disciple of Christ means that you necessarily give a public moral witness that emerges from deep within the church and from Christ's presence working in and through his mystical body. Ultimately, it means living so to point to the value of what it means to be a human person. It means placing who and what you are in contradistinction to what the world wants you to be. For the meaning of being human is revealed in the meaning and purpose of Christ's life. What is being asked of you is that you make your own risk capital investment and place all that you are and all that you have and all that you will be into the hands of Jesus Christ to be disposed as he disposes. It is to follow in the footsteps of St. Francis of Assisi, who abandoned a privileged status and entered a much greater life. I've mentioned this before. A priest told me that when he was a young man, some dark days came upon him in a time of terrible loss. In great love and tenderness, his mother, a woman who herself had known suffering, pulled out from her prayer book the following prayer. She too had to face life's big questions and make the investment of placing her life, with all its suffering and loss, into the hands of God. The priest said that it sustained him many times, particularly when he questioned his own commitment into the care of God. And the prayer has a title to it, Prayer of an Unknown Confederate Soldier. It was found in his pocket in a Civil War battlefield. This is the prayer. I ask God for strength that I might achieve. I was made weak that I might learn humbly to obey. I asked for health that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I asked for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I asked for power that I might have the praise of men. I was given weakness that I might feel the need of God. I asked for all things that I might enjoy life. I was given life that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing that I asked for, but everything I had hoped for. Almost despite myself, my unspoken prayers were answered. I, among all men, are most richly blessed. Dying on his cross, Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Who has not, in great pain, likewise cried out that same question? It is only with great faith and the courage that it produces that we can, with Jesus, give our Father in heaven our final commitment. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. No greater investment can be made by any man or woman. And the reward? A higher and better life in this world and forever in the next. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.